almost all the states have any one form of dance, at least minimum any one form. For example, you take Tamil Nadu, Bharatanatyam is Tamil Nadu's dance form. Kuchipudi, that is Andhra Pradesh. You take Mohiniyattam, Kerala, like that. Then UP. UP or Madhya Pradesh, is it? UP or MP, I don't remember. There is a slight confusion between these two. But Kathak is either it belongs to UP or it is UP only. Yeah, Lucknow, UP. So, and we have some folk dances like Bhangra is Punjabi's folk dance. And we have Dandiya. We have Garbha. Like different dances, but the difference is classical dances are, and say they are more scientific. Scientific, I don't mean that there is something science involved, but what I'm trying to say is there are rules and regulations, proper rules and regulations, and they are in accordance with those rules, prescribed rules, which are there, which are prescribed in the book which is written by Bharata Muni. Name of that book is Natya Shastra. So, Natya Shastra is the book according to which these dance forms are developed. Then we have, we discussed a few names in among these dancers? No? Okay. So, I told you that it is the dance or drama or anything. It is all about showing the human feelings, and these feelings can be discussed under nine heads or nine rasas. That is Hasya, Bhayanaka, Raudra, Karuna, Veera, Adbhuta, Vivasa, Shringara. These are the nine rasas under which you perform anything. It will come under, it will fall under these nine. So showing those emotions or those rasas is the most important. There are few famous persons, famous individuals who have made their mark in classical dances. Okay. So I'd like to just show you some famous dancers. Just a minute, Indian classical dancers. Yeah. I'll let you share my screen. I hope my screen is visible. Is my screen visible?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So, okay. There are the names, yeah. Rukmini Devi, Arundhati, Bharatanatyam. Okay, then it is Pandit Birju Maharaj, Kathak. This Birju Maharaj, he has also played some roles in some movies. For example, there is a famous old movie by name Janak Janak Payal Baji. He performed in that, and there are some Telugu movies also where he performed. So, Birju Mohan Mishra, popularly known as Birju Maharaj, very famous. Then it is Uday Shankar. Then it is Kelu Charan Mahapatra. He is very famous in Odissi. I don't know who is it. It's Guru Bipin Singh. I don't know, but he is famous in Manipuri. Then it is Guru Venkat Chinnasatya. He is also a famous composer. I mean, say he made his mark in movies also. Venkat Chinnasatya, Kuchipudi, famous. Then Padma Subramanyam, Bharatanatyam. She is another famous lady. Shobana Narayan. People also pronounce her Shobana Narayan. Okay, then Sonal Mansingh. Very famous in Bharatanatyam and Odissi. Shankar Dev, I don't know who he is, but yeah, Mrunalini Sarabhai is again a famous personality. Kalyani Kutty, I haven't heard. So these are few, yeah, Krishna Murthy again a famous personality. Kuchipudi and Bharatanatyam. He is again Satyanarayan Sharma, Kuchipudi, a famous one. Bala Saraswati is another famous name. Okay, now, like this, there are few famous names. Yeah, so, as I said, these are the famous personalities. Right? So, now let us discuss the music. The originating point of music is, can anyone guess? We already had a discussion on this. What is the, or where is the originating point of Indian classical music or Indian music? Okay, so it is, so how many Vedas do we have? Do you remember?
Four.
Yeah, can you name them? Can name all the four Vedas? Rig Veda, Yajur Veda, Sama Veda, Atharvana Veda. Yeah, so Rig Veda is all about the hymens. Hymens in praise of various gods. Gods, that is manifestation of forces of nature. Then Yajur Veda is all about rituals. Then Sama Veda is about music. I told you, if you remember, there were 16,000 ragas which were mentioned in Sama Veda. And while discussing Sama Veda, I told you, I remember saying that it is the originating point of Indian music. So that is the starting point. Then afterwards, different people have come up with different things, but there are some historical, some mythological names which we discuss. For example, there is a book by Narada, okay, which is considered as a famous book on classical music. Like that, there are many other things, and there are famous classical, or what should I say, the mythological characters also. For example, Narada is a famous singer, Tumbura is a famous, but let us not get into that discussion. So when it comes to Indian music, it can be broadly divided into two groups: North Indian music, South Indian music. North Indian music is said to be, or it is known as with other name, that is Hindustani. South Indian music is known as Carnatic music. The difference mainly between these North Indian and South Indian, or Hindustani and Carnatic musics, is Hindustani music stresses or gives most importance to rag, that is the alap. How do we sing? Okay, so rag is, or alap is, very important. We have many ragas. Of course, in Carnatic music also we have ragas, but the elaborate recital of ragas, you will not see that in Carnatic music very much. But in Hindustani, you'll find this. Okay, so this was there from the beginning, but in medieval era, when Muslim rulers came to India, along with those Muslim rulers, as I said, Sufi mysticism has also come to India, Sufi saints. They have also learnt, and they have sometimes, it is not wrong to say that they have also improvised or added few things to the classical music. Like, for example, Amir Khusro, a famous poet, multifaceted personality, musician, okay, he have discovered some, he has created some instruments, and he used to play those instruments also. It is believed that he has invented the sitar and tabla, and he is said to have introduced new ragas also. So most of the Hindustani music is somewhat in the other way. Of course, and I don't mean most, but many ragas, many have been introduced by Tansen also, but people wrongly think that Tansen is a Muslim, but it's not wrong, it's not correct, it's wrong. Tansen is a Hindu, but Akbar used to like him very much, and because of that reason, he has given him a new name, Tansen. His original name was some Ram Tanu Pandey or Hari Tanu Pandey, Ram Tanu Pandey, I think. So he's actually a Brahmin, but a good, great singer. Akbar used to like him very much, and this Ram Tanu Pandey, are famously as Tansen was a court poet, a court singer of Akbar. And there were other poets at that time also, like Baiju Bawra and some women also, a famous woman singer. So many rangas are said to be introduced by this Tansen. And again, in Hindustani, different, I told you that different gharanas are there, are different styles of singing are there. For example, Drupad, Dhamar, Tumri, Khayal, Tappa, different styles of singing, and different schools, gharanas are also there. Two different things. This music, it is purely based on ragas, as I said, and these ragas are same in Carnatic music and in Hindustani also. For example, Rag Bhairavi, Sindhu Bhairavi, Bheem Palasi, Darbari, Desh, Hamsadwani, like this, Megh Malhar, different ragas are, and these ragas are meant for different time periods of the day and different seasons also. For example, Rag Malhar is rain, known for rainy season, and Bhupal Ragam is for early morning raga, it is known as. Like that, there are some ragas which are, as especially, they are preferred to be sung in some special times or on special occasions. Like this, there are very variety, many varieties. And instruments also, when it comes to, when I say music, basically, it depends on the bass, what is being considered as the bass. Then depending on that bass, we can consider, divide it into different types. For example, if I say North Indian, South Indian, then Hindustani, Carnatic. If I say singing and instrumental music, then it is, singing is a separate branch, vocal. Instrument is separate branch. Again, in instruments, we have North Indian instruments, that is Hindustani, and South Indian, that is Carnatic. In singing also, as I said, North Indian, that is Hindustani, South Indian, that is Carnatic. So like this, again, in instruments, we can say string instruments and percussion instruments. That is like, for example, santur. Not santur, it is sarod or violin is an instrument, string instrument. Tabla is a percussion instrument. Drums is a percussion instrument, like that. So different bases, okay? And as I said, again, in not only the styles like Drupad singing and those, we have schools, that is gharanas also. For example, Gwalior gharana, Kirana gharana, Jaipur gharana, okay? Like this, famous gharanas are also there. Gharanas are kind of, let us say, if I am a famous singer, I have my own style, then those who like my style, they also come and learn from me. That's how it becomes a again, a special school in Hindustan itself. It's a school or it's a gharana. It becomes a special school. Like this, we have different gharanas. So you will not find this thing in Carnatic music. You will not find gharanas in Carnatic music. Whoever it is, they have to follow the rules and they have to sing in their and say as per the rules only. But this gharana style is not there in Carnatic music. This Carnatic music is mainly said to have been come into existence because of three people: Shyama Shastri, Tyagarajan, Mutti Swami Dikshitar. There are many other singers, poets and singers, but these three people are known as the famous trio of Carnatic music: Shyama Shastri, Tyagaraja, Muthuswami Dikshitar. So they did not only write, but they also composed the songs, and they have also, its singing was also a talent of these people. Okay, so the main compositions are known as, the main compositions of Tyagaraja or Muthuswami Dikshitar or Shyama Shastri, they are known as Kirtanas. Even you have great people like Annamacharya, another Purandaradas. There are many other people who were also very famous. But the greatness with these three people is they have written, they have composed, and they have also sung. That is the peculiarity of these three. And they were the early people because of whom it is believed that Carnatic music has come into existence. If you have to, if I have to tell you few famous names in Carnatic music, then it is Vidyanath Iyer, Subramanian Iyer, Srinivas Iyengar. Like this, we have many other persons. And when it comes to instrumental music, for example, Nadaswaram, Mridangam, Ghatam, Veena, these are all Carnatic music instruments. संतूर, सरोद, सारंगी, तबला, दीज आर ऑल हिंदुस्तानी नॉर्थ इंडियन इंस्ट्रूमेंट्स. ओके, सो डिफरेंट डिफरेंट थिंग्स आर देयर. इफ यू फॉर एग्जाम्पल अगेन वॉन्ट टू नो हू द फेमस सिंगर्स आर, हू द फेमस instrument players are, then again we have, for example, Amir Khusro, Ram Tanu Pande, Baijnath Mishra, Gopal Nayak, Swami Haridas, Palaskar, I'll say both son and father. I don't remember the names, but Palaskar is their surname, I think. So V.D. Palaskar and V.G. Palaskar, Vishnu Ganesh Palaskar and Vishnu Damodar Palaskar. Both the father and son were very famous in Hindustani. Yagaraj is Carnatic music, famous Carnatic singers. For example, Ustad Chand Khan, Bade Gulam Ali Khan, Fayaz Khan, Nasir Hussain Khan, Pandit Bheem Sen Joshi, these are the famous names in Hindustani music. Can you name any lady singer in Hindustani and in Carnatic? Students, are you online?
Yes, sir.
Can you name any famous women singer in Hindustani and in Carnatic? M.S. Subbalakshmi, have you ever heard the name? Students,
yes,
yeah, yes, she is a Carnatic singer. Carnatic classical singer, vocalist. Then Kishori Amonkar, very famous Hindustani vocalist. Then coming to instrument players, for example, Ustad Ahmad Jan Thirakwa, Alauddin Khan, Pandit Ravi Shankar, Bismillah Khan, Zakir Hussain. You might have seen Zakir Hussain. He is the person who is shown in Taj Mahal tea advertisement, who is shown playing tabla. Okay, like this, these are very famous names in Indian classical music, that is Hindustani as well as in Carnatic. Coming to folk music, as I said, every state has folk music. For example, Kashmir, they have got their own style. Then again, eastern states have got their own styles. Even Punjabis have, Gujaratis have, Rajasthanis have, Madhya Pradesh. Okay, like different styles. Dance, we have already discussed. There are different types. For example, Kuchipudi, Bharatanatyam, Yakshagana. Yakshagana is again a folk one. Kathakali. Kathakali is Kerala's. Kathak is the business. There are many dance forms. Like, this is all about dancers. I'll give you a few names in different dances. Like, for example, who is famous in Kathak? Birju Maharaj is famous in Kathak. Shambhu Maharaj is famous in Kathak. Sitara Devi is famous in Kathak. Bharatanatyam. It is Geeta Chandran, Padma Subramanian. Then Kuchipudi. It is Satyanarayana. We have seen Vempatichana Satyam, Raja Reddy, Radha Reddy, Sonal Mansi, Odissi, Keju, Kelu Charan, Mahapatra. These are the famous names in dance. So now we have discussed dance and music. Now let us discuss about drama. Drama is, it also comes under performing arts. As I said, it is all about showing your emotions, the Navarasas, your ways. Drama is mainly, in Telugu, if I have to say, we say it is Samahara Kala. That means it's an art which requires the help of other arts. Like, it requires, it needs music, it needs the creating the ambience, like what should be the background. And it is all about other things, like, for example, you are playing a particular role, then what should be your dressing, how you should look. Okay, all these things are required to perform dramas and those things. If I have to explain, the people will more easily understand if I give you the example of movies. is it possible? Can we complete a movie with the help of only a director, or only a makeup man, or only a musician, or only a singer, or only an actor?
No, sir.
We need all these things. We need a director, but director alone will not do. We need an actor, but actor or actress alone cannot do anything. If we have, let us suppose, director and actors, is it over? No. We need cameraman, we need makeup man, we need the other persons, like for example writers, then singers. Even if we have singers and writers, it is not enough. We need musicians, music directors. Like this, drama is also, it needs or it requires many other things. Creating a stage, stage ambience, then dressing, how the makeup should be, how the dressing should be, then what to sing, what are the dialogues like this. So the uniqueness of Indian drama is, from the beginning, people have an idea as to what drama is. So how can we say that we are different from Westerners? We are different in many things. For example, our stories were always happy endings. That's why you see nowadays the practices have changed. We are following Westerners. But if you see a 20, 30 years old movie also, you will see at the end only Shubham, no end. Shubham card will come, not the end card. Why? Because it is believed we are always positive thinkers. So our dramas were also always happy endings, no sad endings. And we have many famous personalities or writers who have come up with different types of novels. We have historic novels, they have imaginative novels. And navala itself is a word which says, or the meaning of the word navala in Sanskrit is navan visheshan tad krishna iti navala. That means if something is explained in a new way, then also it can be called navala. Old thing but explained in new way, navala. If new thing is explained, then also it is navala. That means if you are explaining something which is new, or if you are explaining something which is old but in a new way, in both the cases it is called navala. So we have famous novelists from the beginning in India. Can you name any famous novelist? For example, Kalidasa. Ruchakatikam, Vishakadatta. Okay, like this, there are many others. Okay, this is about drama, and in drama also, again, these navarasas are given importance. Okay, and as I said, it needs, drama needs other fine arts also. Dancing, music, singing, all those things. So this is all about drama. Now let us discuss the architecture. How were people who were living in different parts of France, different periods of time, and whether they had any knowledge of this architecture and sculpture. Architecture is, we think that it is modern phenomenon, but it is not. But what is architecture and what is sculpture? Is there any difference between these two? Students, is there any difference between architecture and sculpture? Okay, students, I want you people to type your full roll number in the chat box. One, okay. So only one student is listening. How about others? Slowly, yeah. Okay. So my question is, okay, I'll answer my question, no problem. Architecture is building something, like building houses or building buildings where people can live. Sculpture is creating idols. That is the difference. So let us discuss about these two things. First of all, architecture, you can say we people have archaeological evidences to say that we people have, our ancestors had knowledge of architecture. What is it? What are the proofs? what are the proofs that we have to see that we are our ancestors had knowledge of this architecture? Students, are you listening? Students, are you there? Are you listening? I am asking you questions.
Yes, sir.
Then why don't you respond? We have discussed while discussing Harappan culture that the Harappans had knowledge of laying down the roots underground drainage system, two-storied buildings with 32 rooms. They even constructed godowns, dams, water tanks, swimming pool-like things, godowns, storage facilities. That shows that they had knowledge of architecture. So we can say at least from 3,000 to 5,000 years before we had the knowledge of this architecture. Okay, how we can show the Harappan civilization as the remains of the Harappan civilization as a proof? They have constructed double-storied buildings with burnt bricks. They have laid roads. They have constructed a dam. Okay, and all the cities were protected with walls. They have constructed walls. The roads were laid in grid system. That means every road cuts each other in 90 degrees angle. Okay, these are there in Indus Valley civilization. And when it comes to later Vedic period and medieval India, you will see wonders. Later Vedic period, when Buddhism, Jainism and these things came into existence, these ideologies were preached or were famous or were vogue in India, then at that time people wanted to spread their religious beliefs, and in order to spread their religious beliefs, what they did, they went to different places, and in all those places, wherever they go, they have built some viharas. Viharas are the places where people can live. I'm not saying that it's only Buddhist saints have built it. Somebody, some king might have ordered his men to build caves or viharas for these Buddhist saints. Okay, so there are viharas, chaityas, which are also examples, standing examples, are proofs that we know architecture or behind architecture. For example, you take Kakatiya Toranam, which is very famous of medieval ages. You take Kailasnath temple or Ajanta Ellora forts, cave temples. It's also a proof, archaeological evidence. There are many things to show, to see that we have archaeological evidences. Mauryan period has also seen cities, and they have, for example, if you read the history, you'll understand that Pataliputra is a city which is constructed by the kings well before Chandragupta Maurya. There are Sarnath pillars, the lion capital, which is the symbol of government of India now, is actually taken from Sarnath pillar, and this pillar was constructed somewhere around 4th century BC, 50 feet high. Each pillar is about 50 tons. So Mauryan architecture was also very developed. We have Gandhara art, Greek art, which got mixed up with other kinds of sculpture or architecture. Different ornaments were there. They don't come under this architecture, but you know, they were not only just architects, but designing their ornaments was also popular among these people. So caves, they have built cave temples on different places. For example, you can take Khajuraho, you can take Ajanta, you can take Ellora. These cave temples are full of sculptures, full of paintings. These are really famous for their architectural skillfulness or wonderful knowledge. Even Nagarjuna Konda is very famous. for Buddhist architecture. So Bhilwara temple, Rajasthan, they are also very famous. So when it comes to medieval ages, this Kailasnath temple of Ajanta Ellora, a standing wonder. People are unable to decide how these people, how the ancient people have come up with this kind of a structure. That too, they have carved the mountain from top, not from bottom. It is said that they have carved the mountain from top, not from the bottom. And they have come up with a super wonderful structure. There are many wonderful things. For example, there is a temple in Madhya Pradesh by name Chausat Yogini Mandir, which looks like, I'll try to show you people the pictures of Chausat Yogini Mandir. Just give me a minute. Yeah, okay. Is it visible to you now?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. What do you think it is? Have you ever seen this structure? What does it look like?
Wheel, sir.
No, you tell me, Havi, if you see this, do you find anything? I'm saying, do you recollect anything? This one. You see this one? Now, can you imagine? What is this?
Parliament, thing, sir.
Indian Parliament. This is made in somewhere 1911 or 1920. You see, this is inside out of this Chausat Yogini Mandir will give you Parliament, Indian Parliament. This is built hundreds of years before this Parliament. You see now it's a picture wherein they have shown both. This is Parliament. This is Chausat Yogini Mandir. This Chausat Yogini Mandir, from within inside, if it looks like this with pillars. Now you imagine inside out, whichever is inside, it is outside. Now you'll come up with this. Sorry. Yeah, this one. Chausat Yogini Temple and Indian Parliament. So like this, there are architecture. Now you see, it is clear. This is Chausat Yogini Mandir. If these pillars come outside, they look like this. Same internal structure, same. There is a dome. We don't have a dome here. That's the only difference. Remaining all is same. We are not saying that the British architects have copied it. No, I don't mean that. But we too had that wonderful architectural skills. That's what I am trying to say. Okay. So there is many other things. For example, I'll show you one more. You see, this is a place of worship of Muslims. I don't know whether it is Eidgah or something, but it's constructed by some Muslim kings. It is there in Lucknow. I want to show you how it looks like from inside. Inside of Baraimo. Yeah, this is Bara Imam Bada, how it looks like. This is external view, this is internal view. And there is a specific place in this Bara Imam Bada where if the king sits, he can listen to a person who is sitting far away from him, even if he murmurs, that is simple murmuring. Gusa gusa lantanjoyan, ala matlaadukunna kuda adi rajuki vinabadutundi. That is the technology that is used in this Bara Imam Bara. There are many other wonderful things. For example, I'll show you. Yeah, this is a wonderful minaret which is there in Gujarat. Students, are you following me? Are you there?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
If you are inside this minaret and if you try to move it from within, then this minaret will also move, but they'll not get, they'll not collapse. And these minarets are constructed hundreds of years ago. It's still standing. If you go to this, you can go upstairs, and if you stand here and if you move this minaret will also move, but they'll not collapse. You can imagine they are standing for hundreds of years and still you can shake them. How wonderful the architecture is. So there are many other things which we don't know. For example,
where is it, sir?
Pardon?
Where is it, sir?
It's Gujarat. And the Chausat Yogini Mandir, which I was talking about, it was a recent archaeological discovery, which is there in Madhya Pradesh forest. And there are many other things I'll show you. This is Brihadishwara temple. You may not imagine how big the sanctum sanctorum is. This is what is Garbhagudini sanctum sanctorum ataru. So how big it is, but I have visited this place. It is really like a skyscraper, wonderful thing. And this gopuram, top one, the dome like thing itself is almost 12 tons or something. And we don't know still that in those days how people have, this is separately prepared, and they have somehow they have take it up and they have put it here, that too in a proper way. We don't know how it was possible for them. It's really a big temple. And people, if you go to Tamil Nadu and if you ask for a Brihadishwara temple, no one will guide you. You have to ask, saying big temple, where is big temple, then they'll tell you. This is really big. Now if you see the men and women, then you will imagine how big it is. This is Nandi. There are no pictures of Nandi, you'll see otherwise. I'll try to show you some pictures. I couldn't fight this, but I'll show you many other things. For example, there is a well, manam bavi and telugu lo antam, and in India also they use the same word bavi, rani ki bavi. You see how magnificent the structure is, how complex the structure is. This one, it's all same, one and the same. There are many structures which we don't know. This is it, actually. This is how it looks like. You see? Aurangabad Fort, I'll show you. Thank you. This is Aurangabad Fort.
Wonderful fort.
A must visit fort. It's like a maze. You don't know how to enter, you don't know how to come back until unless you have a guide. It's wonderful fort. I'll show you something which is in our Telangana. You see how the carvings are, how complex and how great they are. And some of the carvings are some of the pillars. Scientists are, archaeologists, they are still in astonishment. They don't know how they have done it, because it seems like they have used some kind of lathe machines. I don't know how many of you know what is a lathe machine. Okay, I will show you one more. Where are they? There are pillars in Ramappa temple. If you knock those pillars, you will hear music. That is at least Sa Re Ga Ma Pa Da Ni. These are the Saptaswaras. You can hear these notes. I have visited that place. I wanted to show you the pictures, but nobody has taken. Where is it? Somewhere. Yeah, this one. It will be somewhere here. Before the entrance, I'm saying exactly in the entrance of the Sanctum Sanctorum, you will find that pillar on both the sides, left hand side and right hand side. If you knock it, it's not that pillar. I remember there is some other pillar. Where is it? Okay, anyhow, there are pillars by knocking which you can hear the sound. And the one more thing, many of you people might not be having knowledge of it, but the, as I said, the Gopuram, it is built with a special kind of bricks which will float in water. Have you ever heard this? Bricks floating in water.
Yes, sir.
I have seen it. My father, luckily, he was a assistant commissioner in Land Domains Department. So I went, I visited the temple along with my father, and I could see all these things. So there are wonderful things from the Indus Valley civilization time. Imagine 5,000 years ago, somebody constructing a godown, constructing straight roads, constructing underground drainage system. You imagine, I'll show you one more. I'm going to show you that. How many of you remember? You might have read it in schools, but Maroli pillar. Is my screen visible to you? Am I sharing?
No, the presentation is not.
I'll share it. You see, this is the iron pillar of Nehru. There are many such pillars, but something, he brought it somewhere. It was not there originally. Marali is a place in Delhi. So it was not originally there in Nehru. It is in Kutub Minar complex. Okay. Yeah, this is this complex. This same complex, you will find Kutub Minar. Okay. Yeah, this is it. This is Kutub Minar. This is Nehru. And this pillar is standing in open air. You have seen it's not covered by anything. It's standing in open air. You see? And this pillar is, when I visited Delhi, this was also not there. You were allowed to touch this. But now, government, archaeology department has given it some kind of protection. But still, it is standing in open air. This is far away from this pillar. Okay.
this is the standing. This is how it is. So it is standing in open air for the last 2,000 years, more than 2,000 years. And it is not yet perfect. Do you know what is the lifespan of houses that we build with RCC reinforced
concrete cement? Can anyone tell me? Students, is my voice audible?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Yes, sir. What is the expected life?
Yes, sir.
Of RCC construction? What is the expected life of a RCC construction? That is my simple question.
1,000 years, sir.
No, 1,000 years. If you construct a house, will it stand for 1,000 years? Impossible. Maximum is 100. This is aerial view. Okay. So, maximum is 100 years. Let us say, for example, you might have seen many buildings collapsing or getting rust. So this Mehrauli pillar, iron pillar, is in open air and is facing all the weather conditions throughout the year, like cold weather, hot weather, rainy season, everything. But still it is not rusting. That is the metallurgical technique of our ancestors. Almost 3,000 years, 2,000 plus for sure. Right, like this, there are many wonderful things in India. Okay. So, what I am trying to say is, our architecture, from the beginning, we had this wonderful knowledge. Generally, some people may think that it is because of the Muslim kings. Because whenever we talk about wonderful architecture, we talk only Taj Mahal. We talk about Golconda Fort, or we talk about Red Fort. But we don't know all these things. These are the constructions which, at that time, they were constructed, or this pillar was constructed at that time when there was no Islam in India, or there was no Christianity in India. What I'm trying to say is that as other countries, other cultures have their own greatness, in the same way we too have our own greatness. It's not that we have acquired the knowledge from others or outside people. No, it's not like that. So these pillars, these buildings, these Chausat Yogini Mandir, I've also shown Bara Imam Bara, which is constructed by a Muslim ruler. So there are people who had knowledge, and it has nothing to do with the religion or caste or anything. But from the beginning, those people who lived in this subcontinent, they had knowledge of various things. For example, metallurgy. I've shown you a pillar. So their knowledge of metallurgy is wonderful. Even now with modern technology, the scientists or the engineers or whatever the name you want to call, you can. But they are not able to prepare any such thing which can stand in open air and without rust for 2,000 years, 3,000 years. Right. So this is what our architecture is. Rock cut temples are there. Cave architecture is there. Ajanta, Ellora. Okay, you want to see some pictures of Ajanta and Ellora? Or shall I continue? Students, just respond.
Other pictures, sir.
Okay. This is Kailashnath temple. I'll show you first aerial view.
Is the brightness okay? Is it visible?
This is actually a mountain, and they have carved the mountain. Okay, tolavadam ante danni ela cheppali తొలుస్తూ పోయారు ఫస్ట్ టెంపుల్ కి ఒక షేప్ తీసుకోవడానికి. పార్డన్
డిగ్గింగ్
డిగ్గింగ్ అంటే తవ్వడము, బట్ దాన్ని తవ్వడానికి రాయిని తవ్వడం కష్టం. సో ఇట్స్ కార్వింగ్. అంటే తవ్వడం అంటే మీరు రొట్టిగా తవ్వుకుంటూ వెళ్ళిపోతారు. ఇఫ్ యూ వాంట్ ఎ పర్టికులర్ షేప్, ఫర్ ఎగ్జాంపుల్ యూ సీ దిస్ దిస్ వన్, ఇఫ్ యూ వాంట్ ఆల్ దీస్ షేప్స్ యూ హ్యావ్ టు కార్వ్ ఇట్. దట్స్ వై ఐఎమ్ యూజింగ్ ది వర్డ్ కార్వింగ్. మీరు చెక్కడము అనాలి, ఎందుకంటే చెక్కితేనే కదా ఇలా డిఫరెంట్ డిఫరెంట్ షేప్స్ తీసుకొచ్చేది. ఓకే, సో ఒక కొండని చెక్కి ఇలా చేశారు, తవ్వితే ఏమో నొట్టిగా గొయ్యిలాగా అవుతుంది. యు సీ దిస్ ఇస్ ఎలాబరేట్ స్టైల్. ఐ విజిటెడ్ దిస్ ప్లేస్ ఆల్సో, ఇట్స్ వండర్ఫుల్ వర్క్ సీన్. This is from top. And you know, generally people who let it be modern architects or engineers or anyone, they first build the base, then they construct the upper parts. But you know how this is built? They are started from top because they have to carve them out. They have carved this part first, then this part, then this part, then this like this. Now you imagine how meticulous they should be. If something goes wrong here, they cannot do anything because it's mountain which they are carving. If one single step is gone wrong, then it's gone wrong. That's all. Get on that. This is how it looks from the front. This is the mountain, and they have carved it. So such wonderful things are there in India from the beginning, but we somehow lost the knowledge. Yeah, now this will show. This is mountain. Mountain. Like this, there are 32 or 34 caves or temples. This is a big mountain like this. Long view. Whether you have it or not, you can see. This is inside. Few views. This is another view. See how great it is still. So there are many things, wonderful things which we can talk about. But the thing is, we don't know what they are. We don't know who have. Now you see, here people are standing here. You can imagine how big it is. This is another. So, okay, what I am telling you is, from the beginning, we had all this knowledge. The only thing is, the only problem with us is, we don't know what our ancestors have done. We don't have proper knowledge of the things, and we speak about different things as if we know everything. If we speak, we should know. I'm saying to negate something or to accept something, we need to first have knowledge, but we don't have. Let us not get into that discussion. But we have architecture, and we have wonderful things in India, and from the beginning we had knowledge of these things, but we don't know. Okay, and if you again come to medieval era and say after this 14th 15th century, then Mughals and Bahmani kings, they have also constructed wonderful things like Fatehpur Sikri fort, Fatehpur Sikri fort, Agra fort, then we have Red Fort, then we have Golconda fort here. Like this, wonderful things are there. I am not just discriminating, I am just telling you that originally we too had wonderful architects, wonderful engineers, our wonderful sculptors, that is Bommal Shilpam Chakyar. Okay, wonderful things. There are many wonders which we don't know. For example, in medieval era itself, I mean, after seeing Taj Mahal, somebody wanted to construct similar thing.
I'll show this last one to you all. Do we have time now, or
do you have any other class after three?
We have any class?
Yes, sir, we have class.
Okay, so I'll not show it now. Right now,
I'll take attendance. And if required, I'll take extra class students, because we have to complete the syllabus by the 30th. So, if there is any extra class, I'll send a message through WhatsApp. Please check and join. Now, give the attendance, answer your roll call. 61.